heard the voice of God, and I had been hearing the voice of God. What I didn't know is how to recognize the voice of God in all the multiple ways that God can speak to you. So that can happen to anybody. And so I would recommend, if you haven't ever heard that teaching on hearing the voice of God, that you get that, because part of getting people connected to the things of God is hearing the voice of God. It's a very important part of life. And so that is the story. Getting back to the story I was going to tell was about my wife, who had been with a long time. She had said something wrong that hurt somebody. Somebody took it wrong, what she said, and she struggled with it for 2 days, and she couldn't eat. She was vomiting. She was really upset. And she asked me if I would pray for her. This is the first time for an emotional wound that she had, was suffering, if I would pray for her emotional wound. And as part of deliverance, is a parallel track, like a train track. There's deliverance and inner healing. They go together. And you can go two different directions, but there are two tracks that track very close to each other. And inner healing is a part of it. But I ministered to her about the emotions that she was struggling with offending somebody else. And after she received healing from the Lord, you can tell because the emotion was gone and she was freed from that emotion. But that what happens in an emotional wound is the demonic will come and attach to that, amplify it, make it bigger, and then begin to tell you things that you're no good, God will never use you, you did this, and they'll condemn you. And so you don't want that. If you can get emotional healing, you should get that as well as deliverance. But for her, I knew she was set free from the emotional wound. And as we were laying in bed, after I heard that she was set, I was praising God, just thanking her for my wife coming to me for healing and that the Lord healed her through the, got rid of the emotion. I was just praising God. And all of a sudden I heard worship music. And I said to my wife, "Do you hear that?" And she said, "What?" And I could tell what the way she said what after 38 years that she knew what I that I was hearing music. And what my wife has made so that anytime she's worshiping God, it's always to a worship song. She listens to worship songs all the time. And I was actually hearing the worship music in her mind, in my mind, laying beside her in bed. So there is nothing God can't do. There's no mountain too big. He's just so magnificent, and he wants to speak to everybody in different ways. This is just a new way they showed me that he can speak to me by, in a loving relationship, just happen to know her thoughts, hearing music in her head playing. I mean, to me, that was something new, and it was pretty awesome. I haven't forgot that one yet. Praise God. But I'm going to talk a little bit about deliverance. Unclean spirits is often what they're called in the Bible. I don't know if it's a special category of the demonic. You know, one of the things Vince and I try not to do is make doctrines and rules, because I know I've thrown a lot of my doctrine away and I'm adopting new ones. And so I'm giving you my current belief system where I'm at, but I'm not saying this is it and it'll never change. It's just part of what I believe. But I believe unclean spirits is not a category. It's not like that particular one, although I believe there are particular categories of spirits, anger spirit, lust spirits, and so they do have titles, but that's because of what the effect they have on you. But an unclean spirit is basically, I believe, a breaking of the law, the Mosaic law. It's one of the moral codes that the Jewish people understood. When they heard it, they weren't baffled by the term unclean spirit, although they didn't see it often until Jesus showed up. In Luke 11:16, then he, yeah, you can look, Luke 11:26, I'm sorry, you can look that up if you have your Bible. Can I have a chair here? Why not?
Have at her.
Handy.
Yeah. Just up and down.
Luke 11:26. Then he goes and takes him with him seven other spirits more wicked than himself. And they entered and dwelt there. And the last state of the man is more worse than the first. So this tells you a little bit of something about there can be worse demons in rank and order. It says the last seven can be worse than themselves. So it kind of gives you a clue to that there can be ranking and orders in the demonic realm. Some can be worse than others. So you can have some that are not good. They don't make good pets no matter what. So you shouldn't have them. If you do have them, you don't want to keep them. Although, there are people that don't want to give up their demons. There's a story of a man who was a Future 500 in boardrooms. He was a salesman for a product, and he could not. Sometimes he would be in a boardroom and he would begin to lose the sale. He could tell the audience wasn't paying attention to him and he was selling. He would call upon the demon of financial greed, basically, and that demon would rise up, and all of a sudden he'd say just the right word and the audience would change that he was speaking to, and he would make the sale. And when it came deliverance time, he didn't want to get rid of that demon. And there's nothing we can do for a man who will is not involved. They want to keep their demon. And for me, I end the session and say, we're done if you don't want to give up that one. If you're not here for deliverance or you don't want to be set free, I don't believe you can. On the other hand, the demoniac in the story was probably the worst case ever. The Gadarene, they call him sometimes. But he was probably the worst case in the Bible, but they didn't stop him from coming to Jesus. So your will has a big part to play in whether you want to be set free or not. You can hold on to your demon, or the demoniac who was very demonized, tortured, cutting himself. They said he cut himself with stone. He's a cutter, but that's a modern day thing that we say now. But here's an example of it thousands of years ago in the Bible where he was cutting himself with rocks, and that's something that people do nowadays, and it's because of the pain and the torment that they're feeling, so anguished inside, they're trying to harm themselves. It's just the demonic speaking to them and through them in action. The next verse is Mark 5. I'm going to do 7-8. Mark 5, 7 and 8. And he cried out with a loud voice and said, "What have I to do with you, Jesus, Son of the Most High God? I implore you, by God, you do not torment me." For he said to him, "Come out of him, unclean spirit." Then he asked him, "What is your name?" So this is the one where Jesus was asking the one before he went into the pigs, "What is your name?" And the demoniac, in the Greek tense of this word, it says that Jesus said over and over to him. The word in Greek has a connotation that he said it more than once. He was commanding the demon to come out of him, and the demon wouldn't leave. This used to really upset me when I prayed for people and I would use my authority as a believer and call demons to come out of people, and you wouldn't see them leave right off the first time. But when I read the scripture in this verse, I see that even happened to Jesus. Now, if Jesus can have a hard time sometimes, this guy, the demon wasn't cooperating with him, then I don't feel so bad, because I'm not Jesus, amen? And sometimes they don't cooperate with me when I speak to them like that. And what Jesus did is basically change the tactic. It wasn't working like that, so he got his name. I believe he got his name to get control or authority. There's something about having a name on a person. It gives control or authority when you're able to use their name and call them out in a specific way. So if you just say, come out demon, without a name, like if there's lust, a spirit of lust, it's better to say, come out you unclean spirit of lust. And get more specific than just, come out you demon, come out you demon. That helps narrow down and be more specific with a name or a title or a function of what they do. And I think the rest of that I'm going to save for another night. We're going to be here again tomorrow night, doing a little more teaching and preaching. I guess it's more like teaching. So I want to I want to just open it up. If you have any questions to ask, if anything that I've said, I don't want it to be like a monologue, like just to talk to you and say like this, because I like to have it. This is kind of a great atmosphere for a family-friendly place to just ask questions if you have one. Anything that I've said so far, anything that you were thinking of, you had a question about, you want to just ask a question, you go ahead. If there's any questions. Nothing? All right. So, I'm going to introduce my friend Vince Seller. Vince Seller and I met in the first year of Global School of Supernatural Ministry. We went to Brazil together. It was the first time I really got to know him. It was 2 months into the schooling, and Vince had been touched by the Lord prior to going to school, and the Lord called him into what they call a breaker anointing, to break chains off from people. That word was spoken over him, and he had been carrying out that anointing from that moment on. Demonic people were coming to him asking to be set free. That's what an anointing will do for you if you have a specific anointing. Everybody can do deliverance. You don't have to have. It's just like operating in any of the gifts of the Holy Spirit. You can have any one of the gifts, but you'll usually be stronger in one or more of the gifts. And so his anointing is in deliverance ministry. And when he first started telling me about it, I thought he was a little crazy, because that's all he could talk about, and that's what he was seeing. It was happening all over. But in Brazil, the spirit realm was very real on earth there. And I saw people manifesting there. Manifesting is a visible sign of what's happening inside begins to show on the outside. So it manifests. So if you have anger, and it's a level 2 event that caused anger, when you have a spirit of anger, that level 2 will jump to a level 8, and you'll react with an anger that's just out of control. And that's because of the manifestation of the demonic in your life. But something's happened where you've let that in. And the way demons usually come in is sin, either sin happening to you or something that you've done. But the manifestation in Brazil was tremendous, and I was afraid of demons. I didn't know anything about them. It was only 4 years ago, so I've come a long ways, but I was afraid of demons. I didn't want one of them when I saw them in Brazil. I didn't want to take one home to my wife in a suitcase, and so I was pretty freaked out about it. But they talked to me, a couple of pastors talked to me and said, it's not how it works, and it's normal, and read your Bible, basically. And I said, well, now I see it for real. When I see it in real life, and it's not that, it became more real. And so it's nothing to be nothing to be afraid of. The one word that the pastor told me, he said, here's all you got to remember. Greater is he that's in you than he that's in the world.
Right.
When he said that, I had a spirit of boldness come upon me, and I was never afraid of him again. It became a spectator sport. I became interested and began to watch, and I've learned a lot from Vince and his ministry. And I'd like to welcome Vince Seller.
Man, praise Jesus. Mm-hmm. Hallelujah. Get this mic turned on.
Hello, testing? Okay. So I have just want to open up with a couple questions actually for you, because I want to. There's no right or wrong answer. I just want to see where you are. So I know a little bit going forward how to minister to you and what you're looking for. So how many people in this room have ever cast out a demon? Okay, good. And how many people in this room are interested in deliverance? But you've never cast out a demon.
I'm casting them out right now as you go.
Okay, amen. Okay, good. How many are here just because you heard there's a deliverance seminar and you want to see what's going on?
Well, yeah,
it's
too.
Okay. Yeah. It's okay. Yeah, we all got to start somewhere, right? So, hallelujah. How many people had resistance to come tonight? Okay, good. How many people feel like you need deliverance? Amen. Praise God. Praise God. Because you know what? It's the humble people that are going to receive deliverance. It's the humble people that are going to be touched by the Lord, that are going to be changed by the Lord, because God resists the proud. And he gives grace to the humble. Jesus. And pride comes before destruction and a haughty spirit. We have to run away from them things. If you want to be a deliverance, how many people want to be a deliverance minister? How many feel like you want to be a deliverance minister? Wow. Mm-hmm. Man, that's just awesome. God's really starting to call people up. How many got interested in deliverance from watching a YouTube video? Not many. Okay. Good. Okay. So, the spiritual realm is real. The spiritual realm is more real than what we see with our physical eyes. That's why the Bible says it's to think on the things above and not on the things of the earth. Because if you're to think on the things of the earth, you will become depressed. You will have fear. You will have anxiety. You will be tormented. But if you begin to think on the things above, it begins to change you. Through your mind and the way that you think. I have learned to become very strong with thinking on the things above. Because if I were to think about all the spiritual attacks on my life, it would become very depressing. But I keep my focus on God. I don't care what the enemy throws at me. Many times I say to him, thank you. And you say, well, why are you saying thank you to the devil? Because I know that every time I overcome a spiritual attack, I will grow in authority. And I will be able to go against stronger realms. So what Dean said earlier is that there are spiritual realms that are more in hierarchy. You have principalities, powers, rulers of darkness. You just have demonic spirits. There's forces that are greater than other forces. You have to know what is your battle. Do you hear me? You have to know what is your battle. Not everything that you think is good is God. But everything that is God is good. What if you're starting to step into something that's above your head? And you're not prepared for it yet. But God didn't tell you to. I'm not trying to discourage you, because Matthew 10 tells us to cast out demons. It's part of the gospel.
That's right.
But what I'm trying to tell you is one of the most important things that you have to do is you can't operate in pride. You can't operate in the flesh in deliverance. If you begin to operate in pride and in the flesh in deliverance, those demonic spirits can beat you up. Because they're stronger than us. But we have Christ, the power, the same power that raised Jesus Christ from the dead, lives inside of us. And when you operate in the Spirit of the Lord, there's no demon that can touch you. I don't care how big it is. Now, you may have to speak and break things off, but you will always be covered under the protection of the Lord. That doesn't mean you won't go through things. If you begin to fight the spiritual realm, do you think that Satan is just going to say, oh, go ahead, defeat me? Or is he going to raise his battle against you? But I want to tell you, it's worth every second of it. Yes, I get attacked at times. But I'm thankful for everyone. Because one day when I get to heaven, I want to stand before the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And I want to hear, well done, thy good and faithful servant. Not because Vince did something good, but because Vince was obedient to the Lord. Because Vince obeyed the word. Because he surrendered his life to Jesus Christ. Because he gave God his yes and amen. That's the power of the kingdom of God. I want to share just a short little testimony of my life. I'm going to try to keep it to about 10 minutes, so it's going to go fast. It's just very short. But I want you to have a little bit of background about me. And maybe it'll go 15. But I think it's important that you know that if Vince can do it, then you can do it. Amen? You know, God is raising up people that are nobodies. This is the best time of your life to start walking in the giftings of the Lord. This is the best time of your life to begin to surrender all of your life to Jesus so that he could raise you up and use you in these end times. This is the day. Now is the time.
Hallelujah.
And yes, you can do this. I grew up in an Assemblies of God church. And I saw the power of God. Back when I was a young child, I was saved when I was 8 years old. I was filled with the Holy Spirit when I was 12. But I didn't have an identity that included what a good father looks like. I had two fathers, but neither one of them was what I needed. So I was fatherless. And I thought my father in heaven would treat me the way my fathers on earth did. I was taught that if you were a Christian, but if you were to go home and to get into an accident, you had just sinned and you had not repented, that you would die and go to hell. So I was always getting saved. You sin, repent, get saved. Sin, repent, and get saved. Always afraid. You can't walk out the gospel of Jesus Christ in fear. In my 20s, I got married. I had a son. That marriage lasted about 6 years. But before the marriage fell apart, I turned my face to the Lord and I got down on my knees and I said, God, I need you. Just have my life. And he began to use me and I began to have powerful encounters with the Lord. And I walked that way for 2 years. I went through a divorce, but I still walked in the light going through the divorce. I didn't want the divorce, but there was no stopping it. For 2 years, God's love was coming into my life. But the problem was, is I lived out of self-righteousness. I lived out of a fear of God. Not the reverential respect, the awe of fear of God, but the fear that I'm just afraid of you. And so now that I had cleaned up my life and began to live a holy life, I believed that God could use me. Now I was good enough. And because of that, God was using me. But 2 years later, I fell into sexual sin. I got married to cover it up. In 6 months, my marriage was over. I was divorced within 1 year. And I went into this dark time in my life. Severe pit of darkness, depression, suicide. Many things were encroaching into my mind. It was just darkness. This time, I went through a divorce thinking, I just gave up my relationship with God to get married and to get a divorce. God is done with me. How could he ever use somebody who's been divorced 2 times? That's a dark pit. You can't have hope in that. Some of you may be thinking right now about some of the stuff that's going on in your life. Maybe God can't use me because I struggle. Maybe you're struggling right now. Maybe you go home and you look at pornography. Maybe you have addictions. Maybe you have thoughts that go through your mind that condemn you. But our God is a God of mercy. Mercy triumphs over judgment.
Thank you, Jesus.
But see, I didn't know that. I believed a lie. And for 18 years, I entered a time in my life where I was condemned. 18 years, I didn't think God could use me. 18 years, I was hoping to get to heaven and at least be a street cleaner. I would be grateful to just push a broom and clean the streets of gold. I didn't think God could use this man anymore. 7 years of singleness, I met another woman and I fell back into another marriage. And 10 years later, I'm looking at destruction again. Not being able to stop it, having despair and hopelessness. Never wanted to be divorced. But here I was looking at my third divorce. And I thought, what am I going to do? Now God definitely cannot use this man. The darkness was coming in. I would get up in the middle of the night, 2-3 o'clock in the morning, and I would go and walk the streets and cry. Many of you understand this. At some point, you've been in those positions where the darkness comes upon you and you don't have hope. You just have despair. You have fear. You have anxiety. You have depression. I believed a lie that consumed my life. One day, 4.5 years ago, my mother called me. I want to tell you, mothers and fathers, never stop praying for your children. Never give up on them. But instead of just praying for them, how about you listen for a word from the Lord to give to them? One word from the Lord will change your life. When you know that you hear from the Lord, it's just one word will change your entire life. Man can speak to you and you can go to a counselor and do all these things and it will not change you. But one word from the Lord can change everything about you. My mom called me one day and she said, Vince, I heard from the Lord. I heard a word for you today. And my response was, okay, mom, what was it? Because I didn't believe that God would speak to this guy. She said, Vince, I heard from the Lord. He said this, if you take your need out of your wife to love you, and you put that need into God, you will find him. He will change your life and use you in a powerful way. I said, mom, is that true? Don't play with me. Did God really say that? If this is true, if you can still use me, I will give you all of my life. You can take me anywhere. You can do with whatever you want. I just want to serve you. I want one more chance. And in that moment, I felt the presence of the Holy Spirit, just as I feel him right now, come upon me. I'm thankful that every time that I share that story, the Holy Spirit comes and he's inside of me, but he also just rests on you. He just lets you know he's there. He loves you.
Thank you, Father.
Thank you, Lord.
And I made a decision in that moment that I was going to take my need out of the one who was rejecting me to love me. I was going to put that need into God because I needed something. And I knew that day that there was hope because the Lord came and visited me. So maybe I'm believing something that is not true. You see, the Bible says that the truth sets us free.
That's right.
If the truth sets us free, then the lie holds you in bondage.
That's right. That's right. That's good.
If you have a demonic spirit, there's a lie that you're believing. Some of you believe you have a right to unforgiveness. And that's just a lie. Jesus didn't tell you to forgive because he wants to make life hard on you. Because he wants to take the fun out of cursing other people away from you. You know, we get that bold about unforgiveness that we enjoy cursing people. We don't have a right to unforgiveness.
That's right.
We're not rejected. You've never been rejected. If Jesus Christ loves you and he said, I will never leave you or forsake you. If Jesus has never rejected you, the one that created you and knit you together in your mother's womb, then how can you ever be rejected by man? What if we just started to believe a truth instead of believing the lies? What if we found the things that are rooted in our life and began to uproot them with the truth of the Word of God? I began to search. I began to listen to Andrew Womack. I got turned on to him about 2 weeks later. And the things that he was saying was blowing me away. Because all I knew was religion. All I knew was works and performance. If I do good enough, God will love me. If I fail, God will reject me. How many times have you went home or after your sin, you have hung your head in condemnation? And we say, you can't face God. But who's speaking? Is it your lie or is it a demonic spirit? Because it's not God. He says in Romans 8:1, therefore there is no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus, who walk after the Spirit and not after the flesh. If you're condemned, you're either in the flesh or you have a spirit that's telling you otherwise. How are you ever going to get set free if you hang your head in your sin? when you reject the one who can set you free, how are you ever going to get set free from your sin? I started to press into love. For 1 year, I started to have powerful encounters with the Lord. I would just weep in His presence. I'm reading His word and He's telling me how much He loves me. I'm weeping. I'm like a big crybaby for 1 year. All this poison's coming out of my body. Some of you men just need to cry. Some of you men just need to let that hardness go. Some of you women need to just let it go. You need to just cry unto the Lord. See, there was a difference. I wasn't crying in depression anymore. I was crying unto the Lord. He loves me. I began to press in deeper. There are times in my life when I'm struggling with sin. But I said this time, God, if you truly love me, then you're going to love me even when I sin. Because I know that if I set myself free from this sin, I'm going to be in that same place I was before. If you love me and this is you, then you set me free from sin. Christians have a hard time with that. Churches have a hard time with that. That goes against religion very strongly. Oh, no, you can't sin and have a relationship with God. I'm here to rebuke sin. I'll tell you all night long that sexual immorality and idolatry and fornication and perversion, all these things, they're sin. Don't do them. Run away or you will get a demon. But the problem is I already had demons. And they were controlling my life. I couldn't break free. I wanted to. Maybe our God judges the heart more than He does your actions.
Thank you, Jesus.
Maybe I'll say that again. Maybe our God judges our heart more than He judges our actions. One person can be in sin looking at pornography, and his heart is to be free, and he's crying unto the Lord, going into relationships, seeking forgiveness, seeking cleansing. And they can have another person over here that's just saying, I don't care what you say, God, I'm going to look at this. Or I'm not even going to fight it. God judges the man's heart. Man judges the outward actions. God judges the inside. There were times that I would be in His presence crying and weeping. I would go out and do my sin the next night and I would come running back into His presence. And I would be again reading the word and crying and weeping. And you say, how is that possible? Because God's a good God. He hates sin. Jesus in Hebrews 1 says that He loved righteousness and hated all evil. And that's why God anointed Him above all others. But He knew what I needed and He treated me as a son. And He loved me through even my struggles. And I would be crying to Him and I would say to Him, God, how can you still love me? Didn't you just see what I just did? How can you still love me? You know what He would say to me every time? He would say in the most calmest, most gentlest, sweetest way, He would just say, Vince, I love you. Vince, I love you. And I would just weep unto Him. He loves us. He created you. I don't care what you've done. He cares that you get free. And you know what I found? 1 year later, I'm in Bible college. He calls me to Bible college. I'm still not even completely free. I'm not even free of demons yet, even. I'm still struggling a little bit with my sin. My sin got better as I went. But I'm in Bible college. You say, well, how can someone who's not free from demons be in Bible college? Maybe that's for God to decide. Maybe that's where you need to get free. Maybe we shouldn't judge others. And we should let that up to God. I'm not saying you can't judge outward actions. We're supposed to judge the church. But I'm talking about a harsh judgment that comes from the heart. Judge not, lest you be judged. Mm-hmm. Those who judge harshly, James says, mercy triumphs over judgment. But those who judge without mercy will be judged without mercy. So I just pressed in. One day I'm in the shower. I'm crying again unto the Lord. And I'm just saying, God, you love me so much. It's been 1 year. I can't deny this anymore. You showed me over and over again how much you love me. You showed me that it's about you. So God, I'll give you all of my life. I surrendered a year earlier, but I gave him more. If you think you can surrender all of your life today, you're wrong. There's levels that you're going to go deeper of surrender with the Lord. There's always more. There's always more levels. It's in the humility that you will find them. I said, God, I give you everything. You send me wherever you want to go, I will go. Do with me whatever you want. I don't care. I just will believe in your love. And I started to say, in the name of Jesus Christ, I didn't know I had demons. I just, the Spirit came on me and started to, Holy Spirit just started telling me to do this. And I started saying, in the name of Jesus Christ, Satan, I'm done with your sin. I'm done with your addictions. I'm done with your abuse. You are not going to be in my life anymore. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ, I command you to go from me now. And I started to kick him out. I started to get angry with him. Right there and then, for 1 or 2 minutes, I spoke to the devils. And all of a sudden, I felt all this darkness from the bottom of my heel to the top of my head come out of my body. I got delivered in seconds. All by myself. In a moment of surrender. Maybe what we think is important to get delivered is God is saying, I need your surrender. But maybe you're not ready to surrender fully today because you don't trust him. Because you don't understand his love. Because you believe more in the rejection of this earth than you believe in the love of God. Maybe you look at God the Father through your earthly father. Maybe you look at Jesus through your husband or your brother. Maybe you view him through the eyes of our earthly standards. But you know what? God wants to teach you about his love. He wants to show you his love. His great joy is to show you his love. 1 John 4. Go there quick. 1 John 4, please. Because I need to teach you this, because if you don't get this principle, all the stuff that I'm going to, about to teach you, it's not going to be near as effective in your life. 1 John 4, verse 7. I'm reading from the English Standard Version. Beloved, let us love one another, for love is from God. And whoever loves has been born of God and knows God. If you are to love people, that means that you know God. If you're rejecting people, then you don't know God. Because that same Jesus who hung on the cross for your sins and forgave you and spit out bitterness has also asked you to do the same thing. And if you were to be filled with his love, then you won't be able to hold unforgiveness for somebody else. Because you won't want that darkness inside of you. Mm-hmm. Says anyone who does not love does not know God, because God is love. Let me read that again. Anyone who does not love does not know God, because God is love. If you don't love, you don't know God. It's not saying you're not a Christian. I was a Christian all of my life. When Jesus came into my life at 8 years old, he never left me. He never forsake me according to his word, but I believed a lie. Galatians 3.10, look it up later because I don't have enough time. Galatians 3.10, Galatians 5.4. They will tell you that if you are under the law, Galatians 5:4 will say that if you are under the law, under works, then you are severed and cut off from Christ. Did he do that or did you do that? Galatians 3:10 says that you who are under the law or under works are under the curse. The devil doesn't even need to curse you if you want to be religious, because you will bring your own curse into your own life. That's why Jesus rebuked the Pharisees over and over and over. He didn't want them to be religious because he wanted them to see him so they could receive his grace. Mm-hmm. We are saved by grace, not by your works, lest any man should boast. You don't have a right to boast. If you're boasting in your works, you are in religion. And you are severing yourself and cutting yourself off from Christ. I'm telling you secrets right now to be able to get people set free. I'm telling you secrets on how to set yourself free. That year when I got set free from demons, my sin left me. I went down to a mixed group of people, 12 people, and I began to open my Bible to James, where it says, confess your faults one to another, that you might be healed. And I start confessing my sins to male and female, because I didn't want it anymore. I brought it to the light so that it could burn up in the light.
Mm. That's
right. You know what happened? Revival came into that room. People started getting on their knees, crying and weeping. They started to repent all over the room for their sins, and we started to baptize each other in the bathtub. Repentance is critical to deliverance. Repentance is critical to salvation. Repentance is critical to encountering the love of God. Surrender. You cannot go without it. But maybe you're not willing to surrender today, and that's okay. Jesus will love you to the point that you can surrender. Surrender comes with trust. He'll love you to that if you will allow him. I got set free, but I still had to overcome the addictions. I still, in the flesh, had to say no. Even if all the devils are cast out, you still have to conquer your flesh. The devil's still going to come back around and see if the house is good to come back in again. You have to close the doors at that point. When you get set free, don't let them back in. Don't take the dogs for a walk. Close the door to your sin. If you fall again, repent quickly. And enter back into the presence of the Lord and into his love. I started to go forward. I was in Andrew Womack School, Word of Faith. I was learning about the Word. And then God, through a friend, told me, let's go back to Pennsylvania, where I lived, 40 minutes from my place, and go to Randy Clark. I said no, but I watched a video, changed my mind. I'm just going to speed this up. I go to Randy Clark's school. That afternoon, he says, let's just do impartation right now. There's a 4-day conference right away. As he started off, he said, come Holy Spirit. And I start to shake and to cry in my seat. I don't know what's going on. This kind of thing is just new, but I just knew the Holy Spirit was on me. And so I came forward and he laid a hand on me and he said, more, Lord. When he did, I hit the floor and I began to, I was on the floor in a fetal position, shaking like this on my side for 2.5 hours. This power was surging through my body, wave after wave after wave. I just wept. I mean, deep, deep weeping. Deep weeping. There's a puddle of snot on the floor and a puddle of tears. It was quite the sight. But I didn't care, because God's presence was on me. Mm. You know what that power was? You want the power of God? How many want the power of God?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I'm going to tell you how to get it. A power going through me that day, that it was breaking down my body.
but I didn't want it to stop. And I knew that he was just giving me a little piece of it. Mm-hmm. You know what that was? It was a liquid love that was being poured into my body. Mm-hmm. Wave after wave after wave. The only way I can explain it is liquid love going through my body. Mm. Liquid love. Nothing that any of you could ever give me. Nothing that a wife could ever give me. Nothing a parent could ever give me. Nothing a child could ever give me. Nothing this world can ever touch, not even a little, was this pure liquid love of God flowing into my body. Over the period of 4 days, I had 7 hours on the floor like that. I would go home and vibrate in bed at night, and immediately I start seeing people be healed. Had another encounter 5 months later in Boulder, Colorado. The same type of experience. And this time it was just two fingers in each of my hands, and she just said, "Break her anointing." At that, the power of God hit me again, and I start to cast out devils. I cast out my first devil at the conference, spirit of infirmity. I don't even know what I'm doing. I just got delivered just a few months before. I didn't even know a Christian could have a demon. I thought my sin was all my flesh. And here I am, people coming up to me at school and out of nowhere saying, I don't know, but I think I have a demon. And I think God said I need to come to you to get deliverance. And God began to send people to me. I must have looked crazy trying to cast these things out because I don't know what I'm doing. If you're waiting to know what you're doing in deliverance, you're never going to get there. You're going to fumble. You're going to struggle. You're going to have fear at times. You're going to pray a lot. But I began to just be obedient. And he began to send people one after another after another. And I went to Bible and I just began to minister to people. I would go to Bible school and then I would go home and minister 8 hours a day on the phone or in person to people. And just began to cast out devils. I began to see people be healed. I began to see there be inner healing. I began to see lives be changed. And I just began to be encouraged. Was I ready to be a minister? No. Did I have my doctrine right? No. I can tell you doctrine, and I will tonight. But you have to start somewhere.
That's right.
I made all the mistakes in the book. I've repented for things. But God in his mercy knows that it wasn't in my heart to do evil. I just didn't know, so I made mistakes. Sometimes I even got into pride. As God begins to exalt you into new levels, you will fight pride. When you begin to face and encounter demons, you will fight pride. And if you think you have conquered the pride battle, you're already in pride. And you need to repent. Because that's a battle that you will never win. You will have victory, but you will always fight it. You will win it, but I mean you will always fight it. The more that you're obedient, the more God will use you. The more that you surrender, the more God will use you. The more that you give God your yes and amen, the more he will use you. And he gave me this verse. I carry it on my ring. Joshua 1:9. Only be thou bold and courageous. I think I can do that, God. I know you're with me. I think I can just be bold and courageous. I can do that much.
Thank you, Lord.
And I can do this. You know how many chicken lines? The line where God says to pray for somebody and you chicken out? God gives you a word of knowledge for somebody and you chicken out. Do you know how many chicken lines I haven't crossed? But you know how many I did? A lot.
Yeah.
Yeah, my people I've seen get healed a lot.
Good.
Because I just believe in him.
That's right.
There's power in the name of Jesus Christ.
Mm. That's right.
There's no power in Vince. My name will cast out no devils.
That's right.
But if I can believe in his name, then I can come against them. And I will get victory every time. There have been some deliverances that I haven't been successful in. Especially in the earlier days. And sometimes you just won't be able to cast out a devil because the person won't give up their sin. Nor will they tell you about it. And they'll just act like you're just supposed to do magic. We're not in the magic business.
That's right.
We're in the Jesus business.
That's right.
Yeah. We cast magic out.
Yeah.
That's right. Hallelujah.
That's good.
So I left Colorado and I went to Randy Clark School. Andrew Womack, I got this amazing foundation in the Word. You want to deal with the demonic realm, then read your Word. Pick this up every day and begin to inhale it.
Yeah.
Stop reading it from a religious point.
Yeah.
And stop putting God in a box. You're not going to see God move according to your standards. Had to repent for that. After I got delivered, I spent a couple years repenting. I was a serial repenter. I'm serious. I repented hundreds of times.
That's good.
I repent to God. I'm sorry. Like, I'm sorry I put you in a box, God. I'm sorry that you'll do deliverance according to how I think you should do it. Who am I? I'm sorry, God. That's disgusting behavior by me. I repent for that.
Mm.
I began to see greater things. The lower I got, the more that Christ came alive. Why do you think he tells you to die?
Yeah.
He doesn't tell you to die because he wants you to be punished.
Right.
That's right.
He doesn't tell you to die because he wants to take all the joy of the world out of your life. Right. He tells you to die because he wants to come alive inside of you. So that you begin to see the power of God. So that you're loved the way that you're supposed to be loved.
Yep.
If God is love, and you don't have love in your life, do you think you have God in your life? God is love. He is the essence of love. You want to know why you can't hear from God? Maybe it's because of pride. Maybe it's because of rebellion, which 1 Samuel says is witchcraft. Stubbornness is idolatry. Sometimes we're just saying, oh, people are doing this and that to me. No. Humble yourself in the eyes of the Lord and he will lift you up. Humble yourself and he will deliver you. Humble yourself and he will use you. Do you think God wants to, who lovingly loves his children, wants to give his children's power? Not all the time. What if somebody is corrupted in the heart and all they're seeking is power? If he gives that child power, what's going to happen? It's going to be destruction in this child's life. If you want to seek the power of God, then seek the love of God and stop seeking power. Seek love. Seek relationship. And out of that will come power. You'll begin to have so much faith in him that every demon will bow at your feet in Jesus' name. I went to Randy's school and I learned that they're not as rooted in the word there, more in the spiritual realm. And then I go, and that's no, listen, this is not a criticism of either school. I'm just teaching you something because it's important to know. Both of them, Randy Clark and Andrew Womack, are the two most humblest men that I know. They're fathers to me. They were both so important in my life to teach me very powerful things. But what God then on my third year sent me back to Andrew Womack, and he put another layer of the word in between the spiritual realm. You want to know why most people are turned off by deliverance? is because we're operating out of a false spirit, even sometimes when we're delivering people. Yeah. Spirit of pride, Jezebel, this wickedness. Look at me. And because of that, people look and say, you say that's Holy Spirit? But it's really a demonic spirit manifesting there, and you're saying more, Lord. You won't be perfect. I've made these mistakes. Trust me. I'm telling you because I made them. I'm telling you because if I tell you, maybe you won't have to make them. But God in His mercy never condemned me. He never rejected me. He never pushed me away. All He did was draw me closer and closer. And I began to learn. That summer when I went back to go to Randy Clark School, I come home, and there's a woman having a seizure on my mom's floor. And she said, Vince, I don't know what to do. Should I call the ambulance? I walked over to her and I looked into her eyes. And the demons took her body and jumped up off the floor. I said, Mom, that's not a seizure. That's a demon. Mm-hmm. A few weeks later, we began to minister to her. She was ritually abused in the occult from a baby. You think you have lived through tough times in your life, you have not experienced even a fraction of what they do to these people in the occult. There are living sacrifices. There are babies that are born to be abused all of their life. They never get love. They just get treated dirty, made to do evil, illegal, demonic, horrendous things, and the occult is alive and well in our country. Witchcraft is alive and well in the United States. Babies are being sacrificed in the United States. Children are being sacrificed in the United States. The demonic world is active. I don't say that to scare you, I say that to raise that righteous anger inside of you. Where you say, I will be the one. You showed me by your hands that many of you feel like you're called to be a deliverance minister. First thing, I ask you to make sure that that's true. There's a difference between being a deliverance minister and being someone who casts out devils that he or she comes across. To be a deliverance minister, you have to live a righteous life. I live my most righteous life I ever lived right now. I'm free from sin. I'm not saying I'm perfect. But Jesus set us free from sin. I don't struggle with it. I don't want any part of it. I'm not going to open up the door and let those devils come in that I kick out of other people. I want to live for Him. I want to give Him all my entire life. Because I've learned that love is everything. 1 Corinthians 13 says, if you don't have love, you have nothing. You can prophesy all you want. But if you don't have love, you're just a clanging cymbal. Mm. The end of 1 Corinthians 13, it says that these three things exist. Faith, hope, and love. I would think the most important thing is faith. That's how I get saved. But the scripture goes on to say that the greatest of these is love. Because if you have love, then you have God inside of you. If you want to be full and free of demonic spirits, then kick out the darkness and allow love to come in. You want to be free, just be loved. You want to set others free, bring them to Jesus. Bring love into their life. Think about it. If He is love, then He is the essence of love. He is the being of love. He's the essence. You can't separate God and love. God is love. Love is God. Pure, unadulterated love. Not the love that the world gives you today. Not the love that if you do this, I'll do this. If you honor me, I'll respect you. God doesn't operate that way. I learned that if I just am allowed to be loved, then I can be light. I can walk in light. Why would I allow darkness to come in? Why would I allow something that's not love to come in when God loves me? You understanding me, church? This is the most important thing of deliverance right here. I began to, the last 2 years, I spent 8 months in Kenya ministering in churches over and over and over, doing deliverance, seeing healings. I've been in Ukraine last year for 3 months. I've seen the war and I've seen power of God over and over and over. One day I was ministering in a church and I was ministering to 100 people. And they looked at me like they weren't getting anything I was saying. I could have just been, oh, well, I guess it's not my day, Lord, let's go. Because they looked at me with this stone face like, who are you? I get it to the end and I prophesy over the pastor of the church. And it opens up the door and people start coming up. And one after another, everyone got healed in that church. Mm. A deaf ear was opened. People got healed one after another after another. Demons came out one after another after everything anyone asked for, they got that day. And they went home and got their neighbors. And I was there for 6 hours standing and praying for people.
Thank you, Lord.
I was very tired. But if you say you're going to give God your life, then give him your life.
That's right.
You'll never regret surrendering to the Lord. You will regret not surrendering to him. You will regret not repenting. Repentance is beautiful, not to be afraid of. The same way that you receive Christ Jesus, the Bible says, so walk you in him. How did you receive Christ Jesus? You confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus in Romans 10:8-9. Or, yeah, that's right, 10:8-9, I think. I might be off there or something, but. It says, confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart. The same way you receive Christ Jesus, walk in him. It's important that your heart comes into alignment with your mouth. Mm-hmm. Yeah. If you repent, repent from your heart. Don't just speak words. Go deep. Allow Jesus all the way in. Sometimes we're just too afraid to let him in because we don't want to see. We don't want him to see. Like we could hide this stuff from him. But he sees everything. He knows everything. All he's saying is, if you just let me behind that wall, I can come in and do something. But because you say no, you're not going to touch this. Jesus is a gentleman. Sometimes when you're delivering somebody and they're not, and the demon is not coming out, you have to just go and stop and love them. And talk to them about forgiveness. Talk to them about letting Jesus inside of that walls. As soon as he comes in the inside, he can tear them down and they can get free. It's the fact that we say, no, you're not going to touch it. Jesus will not violate you. Forced love is rape. Jesus is a man. He's a gentleman. His love is pure. I've seen God do so many things. I need to tell you this. There was a man that was at a church in Kenya. I was about to minister, and the pastor of the church wasn't there. I turned around about 15 minutes later, and he came in the door, and two men carrying another man, dragging his feet on the ground. And I thought, oh boy, it's about to get real. They bring him front, put him on some chairs and lean him against the wall. And the pastor interrupts the servant and says, if this man, if Jesus doesn't touch this man, he's going to die in the next 2 hours. I said, yeah, it's about to get real. So I began to pray for him. The pastor's praying for him and he falls over. He hits the floor. He's in the dirt. So the two pastors and me start praying over him. The whole church is watching. Just as you are now. There's a person laying here on the floor and we're commanding this demon to come out in the name of Jesus Christ. The man is drunk. Somebody is high or on drugs. are drinking, it's harder to cast out a devil because they're in agreement with that addiction. Mm-hmm. And that addiction could psychologically mess up their belief. So,
listen.
Command the power of those drugs or the alcohol to leave the body. I'm praying for him. Demon, come out in Jesus' name. I break your curse. I break your altar in the name of Jesus Christ. You know what's happening? Nothing. Absolutely nothing. I'm throwing my best at this thing. Nothing is happening. The church is watching me. The two pastors eventually stood up and they're up here worshiping. I talked to the pastor later. He said he chickened out, so he just thought if he'd get up and worship, he'll let me handle it. So I'm praying for this guy. The whole church is watching me. I'm about to speak next. And the guy stops breathing two times. I thought, God, this man's going to die. I can't even cast out this devil. How am I supposed to raise him from the dead? The whole church is watching me, God. How am I going to preach to them when this man's going to die right here? God, I don't understand. I.
Yeah.
All my attention went on to me.
Yeah.
I began to think what other people thought about me. I began to think about myself, and there's no power inside of me. I said, well, I'm just going to do what they did. I'm going to stand up and just worship, and maybe God will do something. Because I tried my best. That demon's not coming out. I gave up. I stood up. Began to worship. But I wasn't even worshiping for 30 seconds. The Lord spoke to me one of the clearest times of my life. He said, Vince, how powerful is my name? And something stirred inside of me. A fire came back again. I said, yeah, that demon has to bow to the name of Jesus. Who does he think he is? And I went right down and I knelt and I just whispered into that man's ear. And I said, you demon, who do you think you are? You're going to bow to the name of Jesus Christ. He's too powerful for you. I break your altar and I destroy your witchcraft in the name of Jesus Christ. Now you're going to come out of him. And I sat up and I put my hand on his belly and I said, Moto Quajina Layasu. Which is fire in the name of Jesus.
Woo!
I start doing this. Nothing's happening yet. But within 30 seconds, he begins to manifest. And within 2 or 3 minutes, he's free.
Thank you, Jesus.
And he gets up off the floor. And we go home and minister to him and his wife. And he tells us how the demons were coming for him for 4 days. You don't really understand witchcraft till you've been in Kenya. Or in one of these countries where there's 10 witch doctors in one town. Are you going to believe in the name of Jesus Christ? Above all of your fear. Above all of these things that are going on. Above your sickness. Above the sickness you're praying for. You know, I'm convinced in my personal life that the only reason I don't see everybody healed is because I don't believe strong enough in the name of Jesus yet. What would happen if I really believed fully in the name of Jesus? You say, well, you're a minister. How could you be like that? But you know what? It comes as a revelation. You get stronger. With every time that you win a battle in the spiritual realm, more authority comes. More faith comes in the name of Jesus. You grow in faith. And you grow in stature in the spiritual realm. I've seen this happen over and over and over again. There was another time that it happened too. And a woman, I'm not going to go into the story, but she was crippled. And I laid hands on her and the power of God hit her. But at first I was like, she was the first one to come. I was like, God, why her? Like, why do you have to have her come up? The first one. She's the worst case in the church. She was walking like this. And another person helped. And I said, God, if she doesn't get healed, no one's going to be out of faith. And then I switched immediately. I learned.
Thank you, Jesus. You're good.
No, Jesus, your name is powerful.
That's right.
I put my hand on her. She flew back in the air. A demon come flying right out of her. I told her two people caught her and they were thrown back.
And I told her, bring her here again. Again, I put my hand on her. Boom. She flew back. And then I said, now, I prayed for her for a little bit. She wasn't completely healed. So, are you going to be like Jesus and curse the fig tree and walk away when it's still green? Or are you going to say, I guess it doesn't work? I guess the power of Jesus doesn't work. I guess healing doesn't work. I guess I'm not meant for deliverance. If you give up your first time, you may never do it again. If you're not willing to pray for somebody and fail, you may never pray for somebody. You have to step out. You have to start to do something at some point and begin. So I've told her to go sit down. I had faith. Man, God just did something. I began to worship, and somebody at the end of the service, somebody taps my shoulder and points back here in the aisle, and the woman is in the aisle holding her cane and dancing with a big smile, toothless smile on her face. She is an old lady. So precious. See, Jesus came and touched her that day. It's because I just chose to put my affection on him, on the things above, rather than on the things of earth. I could have put my affection on the sickness, mm-hmm. on the cripple. Nothing would have happened. But I put it on Jesus. You want to operate in the spiritual realm, you have to put your faith in Jesus. You have to, no matter what, go back to that name. Go back to who he is. You think Jesus loves them more than you do because you're ministering to them? Or does Jesus love them way more than you? If you can minister from that standpoint, you can speak his will into this earth. Jesus said, command the mountain to be removed. Speak to the mountain. Command it to be removed and cast into the sea. But yet we pray, oh, Jesus, if it's your will you heal this guy? If you might want to come and heal him, I just bless that. How many healings are you going to see?
None.
You know why you pray like that? It's because you don't know the will of the Father. If you knew the will of the Father, you could pray according to his will, and you could speak to the mountain and command to move. We speak with authority. Speak with authority. In Jesus' name, I rebuke you, devil. You don't say, devil, you know, hey, I need you to go today. And I'm going to cast you out. So Jesus, try to come and help me out here. There's no authority in that. That's not authority. Either you're a son and a daughter of the Most High God, like the Bible says, or you're just a slave. He says, I will no longer call you servants or slaves, but I will call you sons. Now listen, we are servants and sons and daughters. Actually, you're just a son. Sorry, women. But biblically, you're a son. Just as the man is the bride of Christ. Sorry, man. You know why he does that?
Is he a male or female?
You know why he does that? It's because as a son, it's the son who inherits the kingdom. He wants you to inherit the kingdom. You got first right. If you step up, you can operate in the kingdom.
That's right.
You can begin to move in the kingdom of God and kingdom of heaven that's here on this earth right now. Where is it? It's inside of you.
That's right.
Let it out. Let it out. By faith, you let it out. By knowing your identity, you let it out. By understanding the word and putting it deep inside of you, you let it out. And with that authority, they get set free. Because he's given you power and authority. You already have power and authority. You have the same power that raised Jesus Christ from the dead living inside of you. How much power do you want? The Bible says you have the same anointing as Peter did. So why aren't you using it? Why aren't you believing in it? Maybe you're trying to use it, but you're not believing in it. What if we just started to believe? What if we started to believe in the name of Jesus? What if we started to speak in faith according to that name? Demons will have to bow. You get to make them bow. You get to see people healed and saved, delivered. When you taste of the kingdom of God, the real, true kingdom of God, the kingdom of love, man, you're going to get just more thirsty for it. You're going to get more hungry for it. The reason you don't have life is maybe because it's not in this church, of course, but maybe you're in a church that hasn't taught you the right way. And they've just taught you religion and works. You're free from that. Let's go to Galatians 5. I wasn't even planning on doing this, but I just feel like this is the Lord, because you want to do deliverance. I can teach you about deliverance, and I will. But if you don't get this part right, then you're not going to be able to walk in what I even teach you. If you don't live by grace and you live according to your works, you're not going to walk in the power of God. And the devil's just going to beat you up and you're going to be condemned. Chapter 5, verse 3. I testify again to every man who accepts circumcision that he is obligated to keep the whole law. If you were to accept circumcision, you're obligated to keep the whole law. If you go to one part of the law, you have to keep all of it. It says you are severed from Christ. You are cut off, as the King James says. You who would be justified by the law, you have fallen away from grace. Can it be any more clear? If you're living according to your works, and that's how God relates to you, then are you living according to your works, and that's how people get healed or they get delivered, then you are living a lie. And you have severed and cut yourself off from Christ. Yeah, I don't want to be there anymore. I lived that for 45 years. I hacked away and severed that off because I thought I was doing the right thing and living in my self-righteousness. I was taught the wrong way. I'm thankful for pastors. The more I see this man, I'm really blessed by him. He's humble. He wants to learn. He wants to grow. He wants his people to experience something that he has experienced in his past. He wants to take you into the kingdom of God. He wants to train you up in this way. But it says here, if you're going to live according to the law and you're justified by the law or your works, you're fallen away from grace. Go right over to Galatians chapter 3. Turn back. Chapter 3, verse 10. It says, for all who rely on the works of the law are under a curse. That's some pretty serious stuff. You want to know why the curse is in your life? Look first and see if you're living according to your works. If you think you're good enough or you don't think you're good enough for God to use you. Cursed be everyone who does not abide by all things written in the book of the law and do it. The law has the curse written into it. But see, Galatians 3:13 says, for Christ redeemed us for the curse of the law by becoming a curse for us. If you live out of Christ and his righteousness, what he has done, then your works will begin to fall away and you will become under the umbrella of grace. And you will cast out many demons. You will pray for people and they will be healed. Has to happen. The word of God must manifest.
That's right.
If you give up, it'll never manifest. If you're waiting to pray for somebody, you have never prayed for somebody for healing, and you're looking for God to heal somebody, you'll never see anybody be healed. Because you don't step out and pray. Not everybody I pray for is healed, but many are. And I'm just going to keep believing in him more and more. I'm going to be a good son. I'm going to believe in his name. I'm going to believe in his love. I'm going to believe in his righteousness. I'm going to
serve him by believing in him. Amen? Okay. I want to just go over, let's go into the scripture here on a few things. Then I'm going to pray for you. Matthew 16, 19. Should have my glasses. It's dark in here. I will give you the keys to the kingdom of heaven. He's speaking to Peter, who is the church. I will give unto you, Peter, the church. I will give unto you the keys to the kingdom of heaven. And whatsoever things you bind on this earth are bound in heaven. Whatsoever things you loose on this earth are loosed in heaven. Matthew 18, 18 says the same thing. You have the keys to the kingdom of heaven. If you stick those keys in and you command the mountain to move, it has to move. Because he says, I give you the power to bind on earth. Whatever is bound on earth will be bound in heaven. Whatever is bound on earth will be bound in the spiritual realm. Life and death is in the power of your tongue. It says in Proverbs, and those that love it will eat the fruit of it. That means you have the power to curse and the power to bless. Jesus cursed sometimes. He didn't bless the fig tree for it to die. He cursed the fig tree. To know when to bless and to when to curse is very important. We never curse a person. Bless those who persecute you. Bless and do not curse them. You don't curse a person, but you can curse the spiritual realm and command it to die. You can curse cancer and command it to die. I've seen cancer dry up many times because I spoke to it and moved the mountain in Jesus' name. Speak to the mountain, put your keys in, and open the door. What do keys do? They open and shut doors. Whatsoever things you bind on this earth are bound in the spiritual realm. Whatsoever things you loose on this earth are loosed in the spiritual realm. That's powerful. You have the keys. John chapter 8. John chapter 8. 43 to 45. It says, why do you not understand what I say? It is better you cannot bear, it is because you cannot bear to hear my word. You are of the father, the devil, and your will is to do your father's desire. He was a murderer from the beginning. Satan's a murderer and has nothing to do with the truth. The lie is the only thing that's found in him. Satan has nothing to do with the truth. He says, because there is no truth in him. When he lies, he speaks out of his own character. For he is a liar and the father of lies. You want to know what kind of demonic spirit you're going up against. You will know because they reveal their nature through their character. They reveal their identity through their character. Somebody has anger, it's a spirit of anger. If they have lust, it's a spirit of lust. I don't go around starting to name all kinds of demonic spirits. There are some spoken of in the Bible. Python is spoken of in the Bible. The spirit of divination that Peter cast out of the girl. If you look that up in the Greek, it's Pythian. It's a spirit of Python. Jezebel is a spirit that's spoken of in Revelation. There are spirits that are spoken of in the Bible, but if we start to glorify demons wanting to know their names all the time, your focus gets on the demonic world. There are many times that I've grown and began to see into the spiritual realm, began to understand the spiritual realm, that my focus
began to shift and to go more heavy on what is the devil doing. Now, it's important to know what the devil is doing. You have to know who you're fighting. But if you need to study the demonic world all the time, that's wrong. You need to study the Word. You need to study what God is, who He is, how much He loves you, how much He can use you, how powerful the name of Jesus is. And that'll be all the information that you need, because the Holy Spirit will reveal unto you all things. Be careful. You don't get too far off. It's a boat that you have to steer as you're ministering. It's easy for to get the tail to start to turn, and you start to go, and before you know it, you're over here and you didn't even realize it. And then you have to shift and just come back. Get back into alignment with Jesus. That's a really important revelation. If you want to go start reading everything, you could very likely get deceived. But start believing the things that you're reading. Focus on the Word of God. Not YouTubes and, I mean, to start looking at what the enemy's doing. Amen?
Amen.
Matthew 12, 29. Matthew 12, 29. We'll start in 26. So knowing their thoughts, he said to them, he had a word of knowledge, he knew their thoughts. Every kingdom divided against itself is laid waste, and no city or house divided itself against itself will stand. And if Satan casts out Satan, he is divided against himself. How then will his kingdom stand? And if I cast out demons by Beelzebub, by whom do your sons cast them out? Therefore they will be your judges. But if it is by the Spirit of God that I cast out demons, then the kingdom of God has come upon you. To cast out demons is the kingdom of God. If you want to operate in the kingdom of God, you will cast out demons at some point. That doesn't mean you have to be a full-time deliverance minister. But if you run across one, you kick it out. And that's the kingdom of God. Here they were accusing Jesus of casting out demons by Beelzebub. Somewhere, sometime, if you're doing deliverance ministry, someone's going to say you're using demonic powers to cast out a demon.
So brilliant.
Do you know how many times somebody said that to me? Because you know what you do? You love them. Because they're speaking against Jesus. They're speaking against the Holy Spirit. You're using the Holy Spirit's power to cast them out. And you'll see that this is blasphemy. So be careful. Just love them. Let it get it right. They're probably doing it out of ignorance, and they'll be forgiven. He says here, but if I, by the Spirit of God, that I cast out devils, the Holy Spirit is the power that casts out devils. Even Jesus used the Holy Spirit, the Spirit of God, to cast out devils. He said, then the kingdom of God has come upon you. Or how can someone enter a strong man's house and plunder his goods unless he first binds the strong man? Then indeed he may plunder his house. You see, Jesus, the house is the earth. The house is also a person's body. Jesus came and he bound the strong man. He took away Satan's authority. He took away the keys from Satan. He took away his power. He beat him. He beat him to a pulp. He made a show of him openly, triumphing over him in the cross. If Jesus already did it, then you can plunder the house. How else can someone plunder the house unless the strong man is bound? Jesus bound the strong man. Now you get to plunder. You get to come and kick those things into the pit. Remove them from this earth. Let's go to Mark 3:27 says the same thing. Go to John 12, 31 to 32. It says, now is the judgment of this world. Now will the ruler of this world be cast out. Now. He was heading to the cross. Now is the judgment of the world. The world's already been judged. Do you know that? All the judgment that needed to take place until the great throne has taken place on the cross. Jesus said, it is finished. And I, when I am lifted up from the earth, will draw all people to myself. You say, well, if all the judgment has taken place, then what's going on? Well, you have been given the keys. Jesus gave power to his church, and he's waiting for his church to rise up and to enforce what he has already done. When you enforce what he's already done, he will back you up, and you will kick many things out, and you will see people healed in the name of Jesus. Amen?
Amen.
Let's go to Colossians 2:15. Actually, it started 13, and you who were dead in your trespasses and the uncircumcision of your flesh, God made alive together with him, having forgiven us all our trespasses. When did forgiveness happen? 2,000 years ago on the cross. Mm-hmm. So why do Christians believe that when they get saved, they're just cleansed of sin, but now they live as a Christian and the forgiveness doesn't continue? Where did that lie come from? Because if he can get you to accept it, he can condemn you. If you knew that you were free from sin and you're loved, you would stop sinning. And the battle that you fight, focusing on trying to stop sinning, would stop overtaking you. If I told you right now, don't think about a red frog. Yeah. Listen, stop it. Don't think about a red frog.
Purple elephant.
I don't want you to think about a red frog.
Purple elephant.
What are you going to think about? Because I told you you can't. The same thing happens to you when you try to control your sin. What if you stop focusing on your sin and started focusing on Jesus and let him set you free, and the grace that came into my life that I didn't deserve will make you serve him the way that I do my life. It says here, he has forgiven you all trespasses by canceling the record of debt that stood against you with its legal demands. That this he set aside, nailing it to the cross. Do you know that the handwriting of ordinances that Satan has against you, he took it and nailed it to the cross? The only thing allowing it to be active and going on is your faith that your sins are more powerful than Jesus. Maybe we should just repent for exalting ourselves against God and saying that we're bigger than his blood. I'm saying some tough things, man. I've gotten down on my knees and repented of these things. It's horrible how we get to think that we're justified by that. But if you look at it, compared to what Jesus did and say, am I exalting myself above him? If you are, you're making yourself your own God. And the blood of Jesus can't cover you. And you're going to struggle in your sins. He disarmed the rulers and authorities and put them to an open shame by triumphing over them. The rulers and the authorities, the spiritual realm, he made an open shame of them. Now all you have to do is enforce what he did. It sounds to me, according to this in Galatians 3:13, that Jesus Christ took the curse. Sounds like Jesus Christ took all of your handwriting and ordinances and that the enemy doesn't have a legal right against you. Would you say that's true? According to Christ. Well, let's go to Ephesians 4:27. Ephesians Ephesians 4:26, we'll start. Actually, 4:25. Therefore, having put away falsehood, let each one of you speak the truth with his neighbor, for we are members one of another. How many times have Jesus told you to go to a brother and sister and speak to them and rebuke them for their sin and you chickened out? Told you to go correct them in love, not in harshness, in love. We're supposed to speak the truth because the truth sets us free, brother. So Jesus wants them free. It says here, for we are members one of another, be angry and do not sin. So there is an anger that is not ungodly. That's right. Jesus had anger when he went into the church and flogged and turned over the tables. But that wasn't sin. Be angry and do not sin. Do not let the sun go down on your anger. Be quick to forgive. Be quick to move past it. Let it go. Because if it sticks in you till tomorrow, maybe it's going to grow into something more. Sorry. Most people have a demonic spirit because they first got offended. Offense is one of the first roots. You expected somebody to do something for you. And you got offended when they didn't do it. You probably didn't even communicate what you wanted done. You have no right to offense. Live your life with no offense. Don't let the door come open a crack. Get rid of it immediately. Don't let the sun go down on your anger. Man doesn't owe you anything. I don't owe you anything. You don't owe me nothing. Husband doesn't owe his wife anything other than according to the word of God. A wife doesn't owe his husband anything other than according to the word of God. What we owe is to live according to the word. If you were to live your life not expecting anything, then everything that is done for you, you will be blessed by it rather than I expected you to do it. Bible doesn't say to live your life with expectations in others. You can expect God to love you. You can expect the word to work. You can expect these things in the spiritual realm. But for man, don't expect things. Lay down your expectations and be blessed by everything that comes your way. And if they don't bless you, it's okay. You have your Father in heaven who loves you. When you operate out of that realm, you can live free. Everything that I'm telling you tonight for yourselves is what you will need to do to minister to somebody else and find the root. The root is a lie. Every demon has grabbed the hold of a lie somewhere in someone. It's a root. You have a right to unforgiveness. You have a right to be angry. You have a right to be hurt. You're not loved. I'm rejected. All these things are lies according to the word of God. Find the lie and the demon will be kicked out. Listen, it says, and give no opportunity to the devil. King James says this, give no place to the devil. I said, place. I was reading this one day. Place. What's a place, Lord? I love to look up in the Greek because I want to see what these words mean. I looked it up. Do you know what place means? Give no place to the devil. It means a spot limited in size inside of a larger area. Oh, that's how a Christian gets a demon. It means a room, a quarter, a living space, and a license. So, yes, all of your handwriting of ordinances Jesus nailed to the cross, and the devil has no legal right. And yes, the devil has a legal right because you gave it to him. You have to look at the paradigms in the Bible. If you read the Bible and it's just one way, you're going to miss very many things. There are paradigms in the Bible. That is one of them. Yes, the devil can have a legal right if you give it to him because you let the sun go down and you gave him a place, an opportunity, a license to live inside of you. You see, maybe the Bible is meant to keep us protected. Rather than a bunch of rules. Maybe the Bible is meant to keep us safe and in God's love rather than this is a dictator who wants to rule your life. Maybe he died just to love you
freely, openly, willingly gave himself. The Bible says that God the Father sent his Son for his own self. Maybe God sent his Son to die for you because it was that important to him. He did it for you too, but he did it for himself. Do you understand, church? Tomorrow night I'm going to go through some of these things because I had to lay the foundation. Is there somebody here with heel pain in your left heel? Stand up, please. I had a word of knowledge for that. I should have did it in the beginning, but I got distracted. Amen. Somebody lay hands on her, please. Thank you, Jesus. Just close your eyes and receive. Don't pray. When you're praying for somebody, don't have them pray. Just let them receive. In the name of Jesus Christ, I break that pain in the heel right now, and I command pain. I command you in Jesus' name, come out of her heel right now. Come out now in Jesus' name. Come out right now in the name of Jesus Christ. All heel pain, come out. I break your curse of heel pain, and I command heel pain to be broken off of her life right now. Come out of her heel now. Leave in Jesus' name. Leave in Jesus' name. And I send fire now to destroy your plans and your schemes over her life. Right now in the name of Jesus Christ. Now, ma'am, what's happening? Try it out.
Good.
Do you have any pain?
Not right now, no.
Can you walk around a little bit, please? Hallelujah. Praise Jesus.
Amen.
Glory to God.
Amen.
Glory to God.
Amen.
It doesn't have to be hard. You feel love now, don't you? Jesus came and he touched you with his love and he healed you. He loves you. Hallelujah. The grace, it's the love of the Lord. He died. By his stripes we are healed. Mm-hmm. Couple of things here, and I'm going to pray for you. Just trying to listen to see which way we're going to go with the prayer. I think tomorrow I'll do the deliverance because I want to just get as much into you. See, the truth sets you free. If I don't give you the truth, how are you going to get free? I can drive him out, maybe, but I want him to come out and never come back. I want you to place those lies with truth and get set free for real. People say, people have all kinds of things about deliverance, all kinds of rules. It's what Dean was saying earlier. They'll say, no, you can't do that. You can do this. You can't speak to demons. You know, but Jesus did. Can't ask their names, but Jesus did. There shouldn't be no manifestations. Well, he just showed you a place where there's a manifestation. The boy that was having seizures and the father came. That demon began to have a seizure and was foaming at the mouth, floundering around on the ground while Jesus was talking to the father in Mark 9. Jesus didn't seem concerned about the manifestation. People condemned me so many times about deliverance, and they're the ones that probably never cast out a devil. People in authority condemned me. And it causes confusion. Now, I'm not saying authority can speak to you and pull you aside, and they'll correct you on some things. You have to honor authority. Even if they were wrong when they corrected me, I still honored them every time. How can God give you more if you rebel against authority? Always honor authority, even if you're right. Honor the house you're in. If I go into a house and I start to minister, or a minister, they say, I don't want you to touch us. I'm going to honor the house. I'm going to preach on something. That's okay, because I want to give them some truth.
But your pastor didn't give me any restrictions. He just said, come and go. Some people would say, you can't yell, you can't raise your voice. Don't raise your voice. Now listen. You can whisper and cast out a devil. But if you get excited and you raise your voice a little bit, if in raising your voice your authority rises, you say, oh, well, how does that work? Well, when you tell your kid, hey, son, don't do that, and he continues to do it, the next thing you start to raise your voice. What is communicated to him? Authority. I better get in line. Now, I don't want you to run around yelling and casting out devils. I want you to learn to whisper. But don't let some... what I'm trying to do is... don't put God in a box. Don't put yourself in a box. You won't do it perfectly. If I can send you away with this, you will do something because you'll know you make mistakes. But you just be willing to listen to the Spirit of the Lord and get corrected along the way. Go to your pastor who's done a lot of deliverances and let him help you and encourage you to do things. Try not to yell. But don't be condemned if you raise your voice and they come out. In Kenya, it's normal over there to yell. And they don't really respect you if you don't. So, when in Rome, do as the Romans. Now, I do it my way at times, but, you know. Another thing. Did I lay hands on her? Nope. But does the Bible tell you lay hands on the sick and they will recover? So it's biblical to lay hands on somebody, right?
Sure.
So number one, be careful where you lay hands on somebody. Don't touch a woman's belly. Don't touch a woman's chest. If you're a man, you hold their hand or a shoulder. Or I don't even like putting on the top of the head too much. I will touch people on the head sometimes. But I don't like doing that because people will accuse you of pushing them over and stuff like that. I never pushed anybody over. I'm so against it. Don't push anybody over so you can get a high because they fell over in the spirit. So when I first started out, I had to put my hand exactly on the spot that needed healing. Because my hand, if it's closer to that area, if they need healing in the shoulder, if I put it here, then he'll get healed because the anointing's going right into here. That was my faith. Be it done according to your faith. It's okay to start out like that, as long as you're not inappropriately touching. But then I began, why? It's the same anointing. Why don't I just touch him in his hand? And they started getting healed. And then I'm like, COVID hit. So I started praying for people over the phone. And they started being healed. And the fire of God's hitting them. And miracles are happening. And I'm like, wow, this is really cool. And then I start doing it over video. And people are falling out in the spirit over video. And I'm like, wow, this is really neat. Thank you, Lord. Now, lately, I've been advancing a little bit more. And I've been texting. And people are getting deliverance through text. Be it done according to your faith. Stretch yourself, but it's okay to start somewhere, okay? Don't be too hard on yourself. Can you do that? You will make mistakes. Who needs healing in your body? Stand up if you need healing. Now, I want women ministers to go to women and men ministers go to men. Just wait till everyone stands up. People that need healing in your body, just stand up. Okay, now you are the church. Go to them and pray for them. Speak to the mountain. The same power that raised Jesus Christ from the dead lives inside of you. Take authority and let the love of God flow into them and bring healing into their life. Go ahead and pray.
Where is it, brother? In the particular area?
Huh? Sure.
Yes, sir. I've had a bunch of stuff. In my 60s, so.
I'm just hearing this. I'm just going to have to talk to you.
Father,
in the name of Jesus, I speak to arthritis. I break the curse of arthritis. Life, I break all stiffness in the joint.
short, targeted prayers. And then tell them to try it out. Tell them to try it out. Do something they couldn't do before. Do something they couldn't. By faith, you have to step out. By faith, you have to step out. You have the same thing? Okay, so pray again. The person that's being prayed for, don't pray. You just receive. Just receive. One time I prayed for a man 10 times before he was healed.
Freedom
to his ankle now in Jesus' name. Freedom in Jesus' name.
Okay.
Just didn't have it. And I do now. It's annoying.
So of the people that were standing up for prayer, how many people feel like they've been healed? Raise your hand. Okay, right here, she's been healed. Anybody else? You? Amen. So that's two. Right there, you prayed for them. That's two people in this room. That may not seem like a lot, but it's a lot to these three right here that were just healed. It means the world to them. It's very important to them. And they feel loved. They feel like you loved on them. Like you cared enough to pray for them. What if every one person that you prayed for, what if every 10 that you prayed for, one was healed? What if every 20 that you prayed for, one was healed? Would it be worth to pray for the other 19? Do you think they would experience love because you prayed for them, even if they didn't get healed?
Mm-hmm.
They will. Now, when you pray for healing, if the pain moves in the body, cast out a demon. If when you pray for healing and they don't get healed, then start speaking to the spiritual realm and command that spirit of whatever to go. If they're religious and they don't like it, they don't want to believe in spirits, then just, I always just say, in Jesus' name, I command knee pain to go. I'm speaking to the spirit. I command you to go in Jesus' name. But I don't need to say, oh, you demon, I command you to get out of this knee right now. Because he's thinking, what, I don't have a demon, and he shuts down, he doesn't receive anything. I'd rather he just gets healed. I just say, knee pain, go in Jesus' name. Mm-hmm. Cancer, go. Cancer is very much demonic. Many, many times. Curse the roots. I curse the roots of cancer in Jesus' name. I command you to dry up in Jesus' name. I pray for a woman who had breast cancer in Nairobi, Kenya. Went into the home and broke the altars. They would worship the false altar. We broke the altars. Pray for her. Nothing happened. Still there. Yeah, it's still there. You're going to be healed. I left. She had a diagnosis that was cancer. She had paperwork. Showed me paperwork. She went back to the doctor 3 weeks later. After 2 weeks, the lump was completely gone.
Thank you, Jesus.
And what would have happened that day if I would have said, oh, I guess Jesus, she's not going to be healed. Oh, try another one. But I stood on faith in the name of Jesus. You're going to be healed. That's it. I spoke the name of Jesus. And because of that, she's cancer-free today. She loves Jesus more than ever. She's repented of that altar.
That's good.
She's serving the Lord. She's excited about it.
That's good.
And she went to the doctor and got her certificate of no cancer. See, that's love. No greater love hath any man than this, than to lay down your life for your brother. Jesus laid down his life. Will you? Will you lay down your life for your brother and your sister so that Jesus can heal them, so he can use you? Instead of being a church that just goes to church on Sundays and goes home and lives your life the rest of the week and nothing changes. Mm-hmm. Let's be a church that's hungry.
That's right.
A church that believes in the more of Jesus.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. It's happening. Revival is burning. We're seeing the first fruit flames of it. It's flickering. What you're seeing now is nothing compared to what's coming. Now is the time to prepare. Now is the time to believe. Now is the time to get ready. Now is the time to do something. Now. Now is the time to repent. Now is the time to surrender. Now is the time to be loved. I want to ask you, how many here, just honestly, raise your hands because I want you to acknowledge it unto the Lord. How many people here have something that I highlighted today that the Spirit of the Lord has been speaking to you, you need to repent for? Amen. Me too. Honestly, I got my hand up for real. The Lord spoke to me about a little more grace I need for somebody. So I need to repent for that. I've corrected him in a godly way, but now he needs the love of the Father. I want you to ask you just to bow your heads and speak to the Lord. Just repent unto him. Just ask for forgiveness. There's something, if you have something in your life to repent for, just give it to him. Ask him to come into those areas. Ask him to come in and love you. Just surrender. Surrender.
times. Just keep praying if you're praying. Surrender. Many times we want to just kick out the demon and ask Holy Spirit to come and fill them. But God isn't a model. Maybe we just need to be filled with the Lord and then kick out the demons sometimes. I want to pray for you tonight. I believe in impartation. I believe that there's a transference of an anointing. And if you don't believe in that, then just believe that Jesus uses people to stir up the gift of God that's inside of you, according to Timothy. Whatever your faith is, you can just receive something. Mm-hmm. Not from me, but from Him.
Thank you, Jesus.
It's His anointing. It's His giftings. But Dean and I are just going to walk around and touch yours. Is there anybody here that doesn't want to be touched or doesn't want the hands laid on?
No, man, that's it. Not really.
Okay. We want to respect that. So can we turn up the music a little bit? And
what?
So Holy Spirit, just receive. Don't pray. Just tune into the Lord. Just receive, Holy Spirit, come. Come, Holy Spirit. Come, Holy Spirit. Come, more. More, Lord. Pastor, if you're free, walk up to you. More, Lord, just come, Holy Spirit. Touch it. Touch it. Touch it. Touch it, Lord. Increase your presence. Increase your presence more, Lord. More, 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 God. We need you. God, we need you so bad. We need you to change us. We need you to use us. We need to know you. We need to know your love.
Touch his heart, Father. Touch his heart, Father.
Jesus, Father, just cut that
demon with your compassion.
Just cut that
love.
In Jesus' name, just cut that love.
Increase your effect
right now, Holy Spirit. Come, Jesus. More. Just press into him.
Father, be blessed with these
press
hands.
Into him. There's times that we maybe don't feel anything in the beginning, but we just begin to press it. We just begin to open up that hurt, the pain in our heart. Just let His presence come. Just let His presence come, Lord. And just release your anointing, Holy Spirit. Just release your anointing, Holy Spirit. Thank you, Lord. More, 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 more. Increase, increase. More, Lord. More. More and more Holy Spirit, more Holy Spirit, more Holy Spirit, more Holy Spirit, more. Thank you, Lord, right there. I bless you. I bless you, Jesus. I bless you, Jesus. I bless you. Okay, good. You just received, buddy.
Bless your dream world in the name of Jesus. Bless those dreams to come alive, Lord, to speak to me in those dreams, Father.
Can we turn on music up just a tiny bit more? Lord, He loves you. He loves you. He loves you. Just receive. More. In Jesus' name, I just break that now. I break that now in the name of Jesus Christ. I break that yoke right now in Jesus' name. Holy Spirit, we just invite you. Come. Peace. Peace of the Lord. Peace of the Lord. Let it go. Just let it come off. It's just coming off right now. It's just coming off. It's coming off. It's just coming off of you right now. Just see it lifting up. In Jesus' name, all the way off. In Jesus' name, you must go. You must go. You must go. In Jesus' name. You must go. In Jesus' name. Thank you, Holy Spirit. 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 Lord. How do you feel with the release? Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Lord, increase. Lord, I bless his hands, Lord. Fire into his hands. Fire into his hands. Fire into his hands. I bless those hands, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
Bless those hands, Jesus. Just receive. Just receive. He's a good God. He's a good God. Just receive. It's a free gift. You don't earn it. You don't deserve it. It's a gift. In Jesus' name, I just command freedom now. Freedom in the name of Jesus Christ right now. Come on. Come on, pray. Come on, pray now. Come on, pray now in Jesus' name. Power in the name of Jesus Christ right now. I command it to come off. Come off right now. All of it. All of it in Jesus' name. All of it in Jesus' name. Just let it go. Just let it go. Don't hold on. Thank you, Jesus. It's okay. Thank you, Jesus. Holy Spirit, more. More, Holy Spirit. More, Holy Spirit. More, more. Increase, increase, increase. I release the power of God. I release the power of God right now. I release the power of God inside of her now. The Lord's raising you up for such a time as this. For such a time as this. He's doing some surgery on you right now. And he's touching you right now. Just let him come more. Just invite him in. It's okay. It's safe. It's safe. It's safe. You let him in. He'll just come all the way. More, Holy Spirit. More, Holy Spirit. Another level. Another level. Increase the power. Holy Spirit, I ask you to increase the power. Increase the power. Increase the power. There it is. More. That's it. That's it. Increase the power, Lord. Increase the power. Increase the power. Increase the power. What's happening to you now is you're just being filled, and, but you're being set free too at the same time. There's things that are breaking off, but there's an impartation happening to you right now. It's like a fire that's coming into you. And just receive the presence of the Lord. And just don't battle. Just let it go. It's okay. It's okay. The Lord says it's okay. He doesn't care about the past, he cares about you. And he's going to use you. He's going to transform you. More, Holy Spirit, ask you to increase again. Again, Holy Spirit, increase more, 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 more. More. I just remove this, whatever's on her head here. I just take it off of her now in Jesus' name. I take that off in the name of Jesus Christ. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Thank you, Jesus. Jesus, we worship you. We worship you. He loves you. He loves you. He loves you. He loves you. You're his daughter. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Lord, I release healing in Jesus' name. Healing in the name of Jesus, Lord. Just more, Holy Spirit. More, 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 more. More in Jesus' name. More in Jesus' name. More in Jesus' name. Increase, 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 increase. More, Holy Spirit. More, Holy Spirit, just increase more, 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 more power, Holy Spirit, more power, Holy Spirit, more power, Holy Spirit. Just receive. I don't need to be laying hands on you. You're receiving from the Lord. Just press in. Press in. Go for it. Holy Spirit, more, 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 more. I just see something coming down. It's like a light. It's just like coming down upon you now. It's like shining on you. more Holy Spirit, more Holy Spirit, more Holy Spirit. Increase, 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 increase. Lord, I release them more in Jesus' name. I release them more in Jesus' name. I release them more in Jesus' name. More in Jesus' name. That's it. That's it. More Holy Spirit. 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 More, 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 more. More, more, more. That's it. That's it. There it is. There it is. If you're going to fall, just get down on your knees. Thank you, Holy Spirit. More, 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 more. Jesus is the chain breaker. He's 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 breaking chains. 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 He's breaking chains in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. He's breaking chains in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. 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 The mighty name of Jesus Christ. Every chain fall. Every chain fall. Every chain fall. Every chain fall in Jesus' name. Thank you, Jesus. More, 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 more. Increase, 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 increase. Holy Spirit, we welcome your presence. We welcome your presence. We welcome your anointing, Lord. Increase more, 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 Holy Spirit. More, Holy Spirit. Increase upon the Lord. Increase, increase, Holy Spirit. More, 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 more. There it is. Just receive it. 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 That's the release of the Lord. In Jesus' name, every spirit. Shackles to fall now. I command shackles to fall now in the name of Jesus Christ. Come off of them now. Come off of them now. Come off in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Come off. Come off. Come off. Come off. Come off and break. Break now. Break now. Break now. Break now. Break now in Jesus' name. Break now in the name of Jesus Christ. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ. I bless them. I release your anointing, Lord. Let your anointing come, Holy Spirit. You say that the anointing breaks the yokes. Let the anointing of the Lord become strong. Become strong, Jesus, and break the yokes. Break in the yokes, 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 in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name, in Jesus' name. Increase, Holy Spirit, more, 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 Holy Spirit, more, 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 more. More, 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 more in Jesus' name. More in Jesus' name. More in Jesus' name. More in Jesus' name. Fill them, Holy Spirit. Fill them, deliver them, set them free, Lord. Fill them. Release them more in Jesus' name. Release them more in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name right now, just break this off. In Jesus' name right now. Be free now. Be free. Be free.
chain breaker is here. Jesus Christ is the chain breaker. He is the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. You will let him go now. You will let him go now. I break this curse of witchcraft over his life. I break the curse of voodoo in the name of Jesus Christ. Break it off of them now in Jesus' name. I command freedom. Freedom in Jesus' name. Freedom in Jesus' name. Let me. Freedom in the name of Jesus Christ. Come off of them now. Come off. Come off. Come off. Come off. Galatians 3:13 says Jesus Christ took the curse for us. So I command the breaking of the curses over everyone in these rooms. In Jesus' mighty name, I break your curses. You are not meant for the curse, but you are meant for freedom, for liberty in Christ Jesus. Do not submit yourselves, therefore, to the yoke of slavery anymore, but be free in Jesus' name. Be free in Jesus' name. You can have all the chains that you want, or you can be as free as you want. Come, Holy Spirit. Some of you right tonight are receiving giftings of the Lord. Paul said to Timothy, stir up the gift of God that's inside of you through the laying on of hands of the presbytery. Stir up the gift, Holy Spirit. I ask you to stir up the gifts. Stir up the gifts that are inside of them, Lord. Stir them up, Holy Spirit. Stir them up, Holy Spirit. Increase, increase, Lord, increase. We need you. We need your love, God. We need you to love us, God. We need your love in every area of our lives. We can't do it without you, Lord. We can't do it without you. We can't do it without you. Break this off right now, Jesus. I break it off. Beautiful people, I want to serve you, Lord. Beautiful people, I want to serve you, Lord. Increase upon them, Holy Spirit. Increase upon them, Holy Spirit. Increase upon them, Holy Spirit. Increase, Holy Spirit. Increase, Holy Spirit. More, 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 more. Jesus, we need more of you. We need less of us, God. Less of us. I just released the concept of the Lord upon you. Just press in. Start. Can we turn that up a little louder, Dale? If you want to worship unto the Lord, just worship. Just worship unto the Lord. This is where lives are changed. Anointing of the Lord in His presence. In His presence, lives are changed. We get set free. We get healed. He breaks the yokes. He breaks the yokes. I break the yokes in Jesus' name. Just worship the Lord. Worship Him with your mouth and with your heart. You know, speak.
can hear the feet of the Father
more.
Running.
More, Holy Spirit. Come in your power. Come in your power. Shake the kingdom. Shake the kingdom. We shake the kingdom in Jesus' name. We shake the kingdom in Jesus' name. We break the yokes. I break the yokes. I break the generational curse in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. I command the generational curse to be destroyed right now. Break, 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 break. Break, 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 break now. Break now in Jesus' name. Come off, come off right now. Off in Jesus' name. Leave. Leave right now. Leave right now in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Shut up, O son, by the Holy Spirit. Santa Rabashe, more Holy Spirit. More Holy Spirit. Increase. 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 More. 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 More Holy Spirit. More Holy Spirit. Increase. 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 So Lord, I just command freedom now. Freedom now to the yoke. I break the yoke. I break the yoke. I break the yoke in the name of Jesus Christ right now. Come off. Come off of her now. Come off of her now. Come off right now in Jesus' name. I loose you into the pit today. You will go in the name of Jesus Christ. You will go in the name of Jesus Christ right now. Come all the way off. 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 Come all the way off in Jesus' name right now. Leave. Holy Spirit, come in your fire. Come in your power, Lord. Jesus loves you and you're his special girl. Remember that.
Thank you.
Thank you. I'm desperately seeking.